Resolution 15 of the Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament. Please just remind everyone present to turn off any mobile phones or other electronic devices. Our first item of business this morning is to decide whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Members have indicated their agreement. Our next item of business today is to take evidence as part of our inquiry into proposals for further fiscal devolution. This will consist of two separate evidence sessions. In our first session, we will hear from Colin Borland from the Federation of Small Businesses Scotland. Colin. Garry Clark from the Scottish Chambers of Commerce. Garry. And Nicola Walker, Confederation of British Industry. Nicola. Good morning to you all. Members round the table have copies of the written submissions provided to the Smith Commission by each of the organisations here this morning that our witnesses are representing. So we'll go straight to questions from the committee. And I know you're all old hands and all that kind of stuff, but you'll know the format. Basically, I'll open up with some questions. I may ask a question of a specific individual, but colleagues around the table can feel free to add their own comments, but I may ask each of you one specific question. And then once I've exhausted my own questions, for the time being at least, I'll then open up the session to colleagues around the table. So, who to start with? Let's start at the very beginning, as they say. Looking at the CBI submission, first of all, in the fourth paragraph, you say, and I quote, the devolution of certain powers could encourage enterprise in Scotland if the changes are made with growth and job creation at their core. And I just wonder if you can go through some of the changes which you believe could be devolved, which would achieve that growth and job creation.
Thank you very much. I think one of the things that CBI members were very keen to emphasise in all the conversations that we've had with them about further devolution is the potential for powers certainly that are already devolved to be used perhaps in a better and more effective way, especially. They pointed to certain powers around infrastructure, especially transport, planning, skills, those kind of fundamental powers that can help to ameliorate the business environment, that can help businesses to grow, that can help create a highly skilled workforce, that can help create a strong infrastructure to help drive inward investment to Scotland and to help businesses prosper and thrive. One of the things that was incredibly apparent to us that it wasn't just about thinking of further powers that could be devolved, but about how to use the powers that are already devolved in a better way, and indeed even a bit of a comms exercise. It was clear that a lot of businesses didn't know which powers were already devolved, so it was partly thinking about how to better use or strengthen powers that are already devolved, so what more could be done around planning, what more could be done around infrastructure, but also thinking about how to make it clear how Scotland is already using those powers to boost jobs and growth.
That doesn't really answer the question about what further powers could be devolved to Scotland, which is really the purpose of this exercise. I mean, I think that's an important point you've actually made. Of course it is, and I think everyone around the table wants to see government maximise the powers it has, be much more efficient in everything it does. And I mean, we've got national performance frameworks, etc., to look at that even in a kind of less partisan way. But it's, you know, we're looking for the fiscal devolution here, so I'm just wondering if you can tell us what you think can be.
Well, on the infrastructure piece especially, one of the things that has particularly interested us is the potential for Scotland to Scotland to gain more borrowing powers, and certainly looking at some of the developments in London around the Crossrail bond and how successful that's been, the potential impact of so-called tartan bonds, which of course is already on the table but not necessarily already in play. We think that that could be a really, really strong power, a really good way of seeking to, as I say, ameliorate the business environment, seeking to strengthen Scotland's infrastructure, and indeed is as yet untested. So that's one particular area where we feel that actually it could be hugely beneficial.
I mean, borrowing was something I was actually going to ask you about because it was touched on, certainly Gary's paper touched on it, but I didn't see anything about borrowing actually in your paper, unless I missed it.
So the separate submission, I think, that we made to the Finance Committee directly did touch on borrowing, if I remember correctly.
I don't believe I've received that submission. don't appear to have received that submission.
I was just wondering about that
because that was something very specific I was going to ask you about the borrowing, and I'm glad you've actually mentioned that there. Garry, why is the Chamber of Commerce neutral on the issue of borrowing?
It's an area that we believe that the focus of borrowing has to be in terms of capital spend. I think that's an area where we do think there is certainly scope for development there and scope for further devolution. But I think on balance, there's a neutral view across the network in terms of borrowing per se. But I think specified borrowing with the specific purpose of increasing capital investment, particularly infrastructure investment across Scotland, we are supportive of and have been supportive of for some time.
Yes, I mean, the Scottish Futures Trust talks about prudential borrowing and, for example, allowing borrowing where obviously there has to be an ability to pay it back, it has to be sensible, etc. That's why I'm sort of surprised the Chamber of Commerce wasn't so keen on that. I'd have thought some of your members would have been able to take advantage if there was additional capital spending, for example.
I think looking at the recommendations of Smith and a lot of what we'd put together in terms of recommendations on borrowing were before that. I think what Smith has come up with in terms of specifying the purpose of borrowing within agreed limits and focusing that on capital spend is certainly something that we are supportive of.
Colin, borrowing?
It's not something that we make reference to in our Smith Commission submission, simply because it's not something that has come to us from the members. What's in our Smith Commission submission is based on the survey that we carried out earlier in the year, particularly just around the, not so much the macroeconomic issues in the fiscal framework, but round about the practicalities. So that's really where I think we can add some value to the process, and that's where we've been very clear that we're going to focus our attentions on.
Yes, I mean, you say in your paper, you know, you mirror a lot of what the CBI have said in one respect, and that you say the focus of any new devolution settlement to be firmly on driving economic growth. And again, I'm sure everyone would be supportive of that. But what specifically do you think levers could be further devolved to enhance that?
Well, I think what we looked at was roughly the tax take round about taxes which are analogous to economic performance. So I think we said there was probably quite a strong argument for devolution round about income tax, because that is directly linked to the health of the economy. And I think we also made the point in the statement about some sort of allocation of VAT receipts in Scotland, because again, that's a pretty good yardstick of economic activity. And by doing that, the hope is that that will sort of hardwire economic considerations into decisions which the Scottish Parliament takes, which we think is good for is good for business and the economy. What we were quite keen to try and avoid was arguing for the devolution of certain powers because we happened to approve of how the current Scottish Government would use it, or indeed the reverse, arguing for things to be reserved because we disapprove of how the current Scottish Government was using it. But I think you can construct an argument to say that making the Scottish Parliament more responsible for raising more of the money that it spends is in itself a good thing for business, because it means that those economic considerations are far more to the fore than they would be perhaps under the current settlement.
Okay, I'm sure colleagues will want to explore these things further. Air passenger duty, Garry, I mean, you're quite keen on it. Scottish Chambers of Commerce has long taken the view that air passenger duty is a tax which impacts negatively upon Scotland's connectivity. And you say that the devolution of APD would not be associated with administrative or economic inefficiencies, and you talk about being devolved to Northern Ireland Assembly, the power to set such rates. But it has to be said, though, that the CBI takes a different view. So, first of all, Garry, can you expand on why you believe it should be devolved? And then I'll ask Nicola her view.
Scottish Chambers of Commerce has long taken the view, as you've already expressed in the comment from the submission there, that we've always taken the view that air passenger duty is damaging in terms of its effect on connectivity, and particularly connectivity from Scotland. To some extent, you can appreciate air passenger duty as perhaps a tax which is used to mitigate excessive demand on capacity at airports in the southeast of England. But when you're looking at the capacity at Scottish airports and the ability of Scottish airports to compete for services worldwide, then air passenger duty is a negative drag on those airports and thus on our connectivity. For us, air passenger duty seems like a tax which would be relatively straightforward to devolve on a regional basis. It's already been done to some extent in Northern Ireland, and we would certainly recommend that it is devolved to the Scottish Parliament. The reason for that is that it is a tax which impacts very directly on other areas of already devolved responsibility, like tourism and like enterprise. So being able to use that tool to directly impact on areas which are already part of the devolved framework to us would make sense, and we would certainly argue that the tax is devolved as quickly as possible and that the tax is radically reduced to reduce that burden and open up connectivity in Scotland or even better to eliminate the tax entirely, as many of our European competitor nations have already done.
Thank you. Now, obviously, the CBI would like there to be no air passenger duty, but in terms of devolution, you said if it was to be devolved to Scotland, this would have a direct impact on other regions of the UK and create competitiveness issues in the English regions. Can you explain why you think it would not be in Scotland's interest to have powers over this issue?
Sure. So the CBI, as you can well imagine, has some very strong and differing member views on this if we look at a UK-wide perspective. Certainly, some of our Scottish members would be very keen to see air passenger duty devolved. A lot of the Scottish airports would obviously benefit from such an action. However, taking a UK-wide perspective and remembering the passage in Smith's report around no detriment to the rest of the UK, we believe that actually devolving air passenger duty in Scotland and not taking action elsewhere in the UK would create a detrimental impact and would create potentially some kind of inefficient bidding war between airports across the border. You only have to look at what's actually happened in Ireland, where the action on long-haul APD has been taken in Northern Ireland because of the impact across the land border of having those different regimes, and we wouldn't want to see that replicated between Scotland and the English border, or indeed between Wales and the English border. We do believe that APD is a distortive tax, we believe that it's uncompetitive, and we believe that actually UK reform is necessary for similar reasons to the ones that Garry outlined, the impact on tourism. When we should be prioritising our export activity, we don't believe that actually having APD as it currently stands is a very competitive tax. But we believe because of those distortive implications of devolving it in one area and not in others, action should be taken at a UK-wide basis.
So you don't believe Scotland should have any competitive advantage? I mean, obviously, if we don't have APD tax or revenue, one can argue that we would have to make changes in other areas of our budget, etc. So surely that, you know, it's a question of judgment in that. I mean, I remember 20, 30 years ago, you could fly from Glasgow to Porto, you could fly to Kefalonia, you could fly to Banjul in Gambia, you could fly to all sorts of North American airports. You can't go to any of these places anymore. You've got to take a train, a bus or a car down to Manchester if you want to go to half these places. How is that advantaging Scotland, given the fact that Glasgow still employs, airports still employs 4,300 people? How many would it employ, or how many would Edinburgh employ? Apart from the business and tourist advantages, if we had control over that, is the southeast of England not getting enough of a competitive advantage?
Well, I think you have to remember that APD is only one of the levers that affects that competitive advantage, because the Scottish Government already has control over many other areas that would help to impact demand on aviation, infrastructure, planning, demand in the surrounding area of an airport, ability to get to an airport very easily. All these things have an impact on creating the demand on the ground, which then makes some of those routes viable. APD is one lever, of course, but it's not the only lever.
Improve the roads to Glasgow Airport, that would reduce the number of people having to go to Manchester to fly international long haul, would it?
It's thinking about the way that airlines determine whether or not routes are viable, capacity and demand on the ground is one of those reasons. So if you think about why regional airports can't support some long-haul routes, it's because the demand isn't there, the capacity on the ground is not there. So improving surface access to airports can help to stimulate that demand and can help to make some of those routes more viable. I'm not suggesting it's the be-all and end-all, in the same way that APD is not the be-all and end-all.
It's marginal to me. Before I let Mark in and then Colin, I mean, I would have thought CBI was in favour of competitiveness and competition.
We are UK-wide, which is why we believe that APD should be reformed on a UK-wide basis to make the UK more competitive.
But not Scotland within that. Mark?
Touching on this, the APD angle here, I mean, did the CBI receive any input at all? I mean, I don't have a list of members of the CBI in front of me, and I know it has it's changed recently. Are any of the airports members of CBI, and did they have input into this? Because from my meetings with my local airport, they're very keen to see APD devolved and devolved early.
Sure. As I've already said, some of our Scottish members would be very keen to see APD devolved, and the Scottish airports are some who, of course, would be very keen. We also have many other airports throughout the rest of the UK who would not be keen for APD to be devolved for the reasons I've already outlined. So we try to take a UK-wide perspective for that reason.
And I note the point you make about, you know, improving the infrastructure roundabout airports, and that's happening in many of the locations. But when an airline is looking at developing a route, it looks at basically its outgoings, its income, and APD is forming a large part of that. Indeed, I'm aware from discussions I've had with a number of airlines and also airports that there are some routes which currently are sitting on the shelf and cannot be progressed because they are economically unviable as a consequence of APD. So I'd just be interested, because, you know, this isn't just about the airports themselves. Many, I mean, particularly in Aberdeen, which I represent, the airport is a vital business hub, particularly for the oil and gas sector, in order to, you know, gain access to, for example, London and other key markets. So I'd be interested to know what evidence you've taken in terms of, you know, what the impact of APD is having on development of routes, particularly routes from Scottish airports, and not just tourist routes, but key business routes and key business destinations. And maybe that's an appropriate point to maybe open it up for Garry to have some input as well, convener.
Sorry, were you going to respond to that? No?
I was just going to agree completely that you know, the impact of APD is palpable on some of these new routes. But again, this is not just a Scottish issue. This is something that is happening across the UK, which is why we take that UK-wide perspective. But I don't disagree at all.
Colin?
Yeah, I mean, it's not something that we make reference to in our Smith Commission submission, and that's simply because it's not an issue in which we've been involved in any great detail over the years. It won't surprise you to learn that if we ask our members what their transport priorities are, it's fixed local roads, and that's where most of our attention has been. That said, what's proposed in Smith seems, you know, definitely sensible to us, and I think we're quite relaxed about it.
Thank you for that. Garry, Scottish Chamber of Commerce, you say 68% of businesses respond they would like the Scottish Parliament to have more powers, and one of the powers that you've mentioned specifically is control of certain aspects of immigration, for example, the devolution of rules for student visas in order to take full advantage of the interest in Scotland's world-class universities shown by talented, high-potential individuals from across the world. I wonder if you can just tell us a wee bit more about your views on that particular issue and how you think that could work and what the economic impact could be.
Yeah, I mean, we certainly think that Scotland needs to take absolute full advantage of all of the assets and advantages that we have as a nation, and one of those assets and advantages is our world-class education system. It reaches out across the globe. It attracts the finest minds from countries far and wide, and we certainly believe that we need to take the fullest possible advantage of that. Certainly, recent restrictions in visa entry into the UK for study purposes and remaining in the UK following completion of a course of education have been restricted. That has been very noticeable, and not just by the universities, but also by talking to some of the airports who have noticed a significant drop in terms of long-haul passengers coming in from nations such as China in recent years. We believe that we need to take full advantage of those universities and colleges who are attracting the finest minds. We need to get more young people from across the world into those universities, and we need to take full advantage of them while they're there and after they're there. So in other words, whilst it's great news for the universities if they're able to attract international students in terms of raising income from and revenue from that source, we believe that we also need to ensure that as many as possible of those students have full opportunity to participate in the Scottish business environment after graduation, so that when and if they go about their business in any part of the world, that they take something of Scotland with them and they build up a network of connectivity with Scotland, and Scotland builds up a network of connectivity with them, which will stand Scotland in good stead for many, many years to come. I think we look at product of Scottish colleges and universities, we see it in terms of leadership of countries and businesses all over the world, and we need to make the fullest possible advantage of that. And by giving Scotland some leeway in terms of allowing us to take that advantage, we believe it would be to Scotland's long-term benefit.
Any idea what the kind of benefit to Scotland would be of that policy? I mean, in terms of the impact on spend in Scotland, employment impacts, whatever?
We haven't taken a fixed view in terms of what the immediate benefit would be. I think clearly there would be benefit directly to the universities in terms of spend within those universities and purchasing education within those universities. But I think we're also looking at the longer term, perhaps more intangible benefits of networks being built up with key individuals who are emerging across the globe,
etc. Yeah, familiarity, all that, and of course the money that students who come here actually spend in,
absolutely,
you know, in the shops and businesses of your members. Colin, is that something which the Federation of Small Businesses would support?
Yeah, and I think it seems, you know, perfectly logical if we're going to all that effort to attract the brightest young people to the country. If they're looking for somewhere to settle down, start a family, buy a house and start contributing seriously to the economy, then it would be brilliant if it was here. You know, I think that's, you know, that's got to be good news for the economy, and, you know, the small businesses forming part of that, then, yeah, it's, that's in our members' interests.
And what's the CBI view, Nicola?
So, to be honest, it's not something that members have raised with us at all.
I didn't see it in your report. That's why I was wondering, actually.
No, it's not something that members have flagged as being something that they would like to see pursued in this devolution process. It's something I'm very happy to go away and ask about and come back to the committee, but as I say, there's been no appetite for it from our members.
Okay, well, thank you for that. I'm going to stick with you, Nicola, just now, and this is going to be the last question because I want to allow colleagues around the table to come in and cover other areas and perhaps even revisit some of the ones we've already discussed. And it's just on the national minimum wage. You say that CBI are not in favour of devolution of the national minimum wage, and you talk about businesses fear the politicisation of the process. It would inevitably follow the creation of competing minimum wages, with employers and employees losing out depending on the political weather. And prior to that, that was in paragraph 14 of your submission, paragraph 11, you'd said that there was possibly a race to the bottom. Why a race to the bottom? Why not a race to the top?
Well, what we received in terms of feedback from our members was obviously very strong support for the minimum wage, very strong support for the evidence-based way in which the Low Pay Commission goes about setting it, and indeed very strong support for what Lord Smith reported back on in terms of his proposal to keep the minimum wage reserved. We see pay in the UK and in the Scottish private sectors as following fairly similar structures, and they enjoy similar percentiles. We don't believe that the pay structures in Scotland and the pay structures in the rest of the UK necessitate a different minimum wage. We believe that the evidence-based approach that the Low Pay Commission takes would result in a similar result for Scotland as in the rest of the UK, and we don't see any particular need for Scotland, therefore, to seek to devolve the minimum wage. We believe that the evidence-based approach that the Low Pay Commission takes is something that's suitable for the UK as a whole and indeed for Scotland.
Okay. I was going to follow that up, but the Deputy Convener is keen to come in with a supplementary.
On that kind of theme, then, would you also be against the London waiting allowance?
Again, it's not something that we've asked our members specifically, but I'm very happy to come back to you. It's.
It just seems to me if you want a level playing field for the minimum wage, we should also have a level playing field for all wages.
Well, the point is that the pay structure in Scotland and the pay structure in the UK as a whole are relatively similar. London is, as you all know, quite a different planet.
Thank you. Yes, indeed. So if Scotland decided that it would believe that the national minimum wage should be higher, that was a consensus. Scotland, you don't think we should have the ability to change that?
Well, again, that would be a political rather than an economic decision.
But you don't think we should have the ability to change it, is the point I'm making?
Well, I believe that the reason that the national minimum wage has worked so well is because of the evidence-based approach that has been taken, the way that the Low Pay Commission has studied trends, changes in the economy, looked at future trends, and made a recommendation based on that, which has enabled businesses to absorb any rises in the national minimum wage and jobs not to be lost as a result.
How has it worked well if more than half people living in poverty are having to actually get, taxpayer subsidies, actually, because the minimum wage is slow? If it's not a living wage and it has to be subsidised by the taxpayer, then clearly it's set too low, is it not?
Well, I think we're perhaps going slightly off the issue here, but, as I say, the test for whether or not the minimum wage is working is whether or not the private sector can absorb that rise, and I would suggest that actually, since the national minimum wage has been implemented, the private sector has been able to absorb that, and we have not seen job losses. We have seen economic growth, and I think a lot of businesses would point to it as being a success.
The government, when the minimum wage was being introduced, were talking about hundreds of thousands of people losing their jobs if a minimum wage came in. It didn't actually happen. Do you think that there is a role for Scotland to set a minimum wage, or? Regardless of what that wage is, or do you think it should continue? Does the FSB think it should continue to be set at UK level?
I think, first and foremost, we would like the Low Pay Commission to continue, or something analogous to it, because it's had that responsibility of setting the minimum wage at the absolute highest level it possibly can without damaging jobs. And I think that has been good, and I think that's something we would want to safeguard. Now, whether or not you could then transplant that into a Scottish context as a matter for debate. But Mr. Mason made the point about there being, there's a London living wage, which is different from elsewhere in England. So would it just be why would you have one that just covered Scotland as a whole? If you're going to concede that principle, would it be, more reflective of living standards to have, say, regional minimum wages? I imagine the cost of living in your constituency and Mr. McDonald's is quite different. So I think, again, I don't think we have any, we're not wedded ideologically to keeping it, keeping it on a UK-wide except London basis. But I'm not sure, is there a case for just doing it Scotland as Scotland, or if you're going to take that step, would it be more reflective to do it regionally? I think that's absolutely something that we could investigate and debate and see what the actual practicalities round about that would be, and what the effect on real wage levels would be in the end.
Okay, thank you. I mean, Garry, a number of your members are being accredited with actually paying a living wage. Is this something that we should have powers over in Scotland in view of the Chamber of Commerce?
The view that our members have taken in terms of employment regulations as a whole is that they should remain reserved, simply because they're large and complex enough without creating potentially two sets of them. And adding to complexity. In terms of the living wage situation, it is something we are having a conversation with our membership at the moment regarding that, and it's an area that we haven't yet taken a view on, but we will likely do so in the next few months.
Thank you for that. I'm now going to open up the session to colleagues around the table. First person to ask questions will be Jean, to be followed by Mark.
Good morning. I'm going to continue on the same theme, largely because I think if reading the paper from the CBI, Nicola, there's an impression that there's a kind of stable economy that we would be foolish were we to vote for independence to break away from. But my question really is that in page 4, and we've referred to paragraph 11, the UK labour market works, but it's not working for a lot of people. I mean, as more and more businesses make the transition to paying the living wage in Scotland, why do you make no mention of this? And what is your position? Now, I know that you've partially answered that already. And just a comment on paragraph 14, where you say that the CBI supports the continuation of UK national minimum wage and in fact, really supportive, but we must acknowledge that, in fact, business organisations fought pretty hard not to have a minimum wage when it was proposed by the Labour Party at the time. Minimum wage has been static for a long time, and, you know, the stable economy that you talk about is not a stable workforce. I mean, if we look at some of the facts, the fact is that wages have grown in the financial sector at 19% in the last year, and living standards have dropped by 44%. I mean, it's quite shocking. How does the CBI really support this?
Sure. So I absolutely agree that living standards is something that, it's something that concerns our members greatly. It's something that the CBI has done a lot of work on and spoken quite extensively about at our annual conference last November. It was essentially the theme. Our flagship report was around better off Britain and what could be done to ensure that living standards are increased. We've had quite a jobs-rich recovery, but we haven't seen wages following suit. One of the things that our businesses were very keen to pursue, for example, is a cut to employee NICs contributions as a means to help boost living standards. We've done a lot of work around the education system, around flexible childcare, and indeed very supportive of a lot of the conversations that have been happening within the Scottish Government around universal childcare, very supportive of that. And certainly regarding the living wage, our message has always been that where employers can afford to pay it, then they will pay it. And certainly it's not the CBI's place to dictate in any way which employers should choose to pay that, which is why we don't make reference directly to it in our submission, because we don't necessarily think that it's something that should be mandated. We believe that where employers can afford to pay it, they will pay it.
And by the same token, do you have any comment to make on your members who may on zero-hours contracts or short-time temporary contracts, other things that make our workforce unstable and living almost impossible for a number of people?
Sure. I mean, in terms of things like zero-hours contracts, again, these are legal employment contracts, and I know it's something that the Department for Business has looked at very carefully. Certainly where there are any abuses taking place, the CBI has been very clear that the letter of the law must be followed and that where abuses are taking place, then maximum penalties should be applied. There's no excuse for any abuses, but certainly zero-hours contracts are part of the current employment landscape. They are used... they are not used widely, but where they are used, sometimes it is to the benefit of the employer, sometimes to the benefit of the employee. But again, if they are being used in the wrong way, then that should not be tolerated.
But you don't think the evidence is there to show that they are being used in the wrong way?
I think we're still some way from seeing a strong evidence base for any kind of change around zero-hours contracts. As I say, where they are being abused, then that should not be tolerated.
And going back then to an earlier statement about competitiveness and unfair competitiveness or disadvantage to any other part of the United Kingdom that independence would have brought. By the same token, had we, because I understand that a majority of people putting in responses to the Smith Commission actually did want to have the power of adjusting the minimum wage in Scotland, do you not think that that then in turn might have actually set a competitive advantage to which the other part of the United Kingdom could have been challenged in a good way? I mean, for all the right reasons.
Sorry, a competitive advantage in terms of a higher or a lower minimum wage?
Well, to be able to adjust the minimum wage, I mean, to have the power over control of the minimum wage in Scotland is something that I understand an enormous number of the respondents to the Smith Commission actually asked for.
Yeah.
And I know it's not being recommended, but to go back to some of your earlier statements about the differences and why they should all remain the same in order that, you know, this stability, which I think would be questioned by a lot of people that we have stability. Do you not see that having the power here could actually influence other parts of the United Kingdom?
So again, I come back to my earliest minimum wage works. It works because it's evidence-based. And if you look at the jobs market in Scotland and the jobs market in the rest of the UK and pay differentials, there isn't really that much difference. So from an evidence perspective, even if the minimum wage were to be devolved, you probably wouldn't end up with a different rate purely based on the evidence. If there were a political decision to be made to increase the minimum wage, for example, then that would be different, and you may actually have the impact of that may result in Scotland being more uncompetitive because it's been taken on a political rather than an economic basis, and it would make it harder for the private sector to absorb that rise.
And yet, what we do know is that the Scottish Government is encouraging everybody to pay a living wage, which is a considerable increase on the minimum wage at the moment, and yet the CBI sees no place for that in its paper to recognise that. The Chamber of Commerce are consulting with members. I'm sure the FSB members will be very interested in that too. And if we generally increase that, we increase the well-being of everybody in the country.
As I say, where employers can afford to pay the living wage, then they will. It's not for the CBI to mandate it in any way. It's not for us to say that the living wage should be paid to all, because a lot of employers perhaps can't afford that.
Okay, thank you. I would be interested to hear from FSB and Chamber of Commerce too on some of these points. I mean, how are you, for example, the Chamber of Commerce is asking members about the living wage, and do you have the low pay units evidence based on the improvement when people are actually paid the living wage now of stability and lack of staff turnover and so on? I mean, the evidence is growing and mounting that there has to be an increase.
Well, certainly that's one side of the argument. We'll be taking that fully on board. Obviously, the other side of the argument is that there are businesses in our membership who would tell us that if their staff costs rise, then they would have to adjust staff levels. And that may not be clearly of benefit to employees. if staff levels were reduced as a result of an enforced increase in staff costs. So I think we'll be looking at both sides of the argument in terms of the living wage, and obviously it is a very important issue for us because it's something which is probably fairly central to the Scottish Government's Scottish Business Pledge, and we'll obviously be responding to that in due course as well. I think in terms of some of the wider issues, I mean, some of our most recent surveys of our membership have identified rising wage levels and a number of employers increasing wages, and some of them at a substantial amount in recent months. That's, I think, to be welcomed, that those employers are able to, in some cases, are able to afford it when they weren't before, and in other cases are having to pay more in order to attract the staff that they need in order to undertake their work. I think that's positive, and alongside the evidence that we're also picking up of an increase in business investment and staff training, then I think those are some positive signs for the economy at the beginning of this year. But it remains to be seen how successful that will continue throughout the course of this year. But there's some positive signs there in terms of wage growth that we're picking up from our members as the economy picks up.
And would you agree that many businesses said they couldn't afford to pay the minimum wage when it was introduced, but somehow they managed? And that if something as fundamental as setting the minimum wage across the board actually helps all businesses because everybody has to pay it. It's not a question of whether one business can afford to pay it or not. It's about businesses not wanting people to live in poverty.
Well, clearly it's not an issue. It's if it's applied across the board, then it applies equally. But equally, it may impact on some businesses more than others in terms of having an increase in an associated increase in staff costs, and it may impact on employment. But that's a matter that it's difficult to generalise on, but the circumstances of individual business will dictate the response to that.
Just, I mean, last part on the unemployment, but, I mean, the low wage is affecting employment. We say that we've reduced unemployment, which is true, but would you agree that we've got perhaps, you know, quantity, not quality?
I think there's still a case in terms of the relatively slow growth in wages and the negative impact that is having compared to historic levels of inflation. Because up until now, a lot of the increase in economic growth within the UK and in Scotland has been down to consumer demand. And where consumer demand is driving economic growth, at a time when real wages are falling, then clearly that's not a sustainable situation in the medium to long term. That's why I've pointed out that some of the evidence that we're now picking up is that there have been pretty healthy levels of wage growth over the past 3 months, in some sectors in particular, notably the construction sector, but also right across all of the sectors that we monitor, which includes manufacturing, retail, tourism, as well as construction and financial and business services. So we're picking up a pretty healthy level of wage growth, but I think that is absolutely essential if we are to maintain a balanced economic recovery.
Okay, remember it's further fiscal devolution is the focus, not just general economic issues, Jean.
Indeed, but I think it's key to it, obviously, Convener. Colin, on the Federation of Small Businesses, in your submission to us, you say that you're certain that the Scottish Parliament is set to become a more powerful actor in our economy. I mean, we know from the unbalanced nature of the UK economy that growth has become decoupled from rising living standards. But in the, as I've shown in earlier questions, I mean, economic growth does not necessarily lead to increased living standards. So what particular power would you see coming to the Scottish Parliament that would make us become a more powerful actor in our economy.
I think if you, for example, are responsible for income tax or a large number of income tax receipts, and your ability to spend on whatever government's in power on their particular priorities is linked directly to the health of the economy, then that has got to be good news for the quality of decision making, because it means that you're thinking more about the practical impact, the effect on the businesses which make up that economy. Because if you don't do that, then you're not going to have the money to spend. Now, I accept that quite how that mechanism is brought into effect, how we do that, how we make sure that we prioritise economic growth in Scotland without damaging the relationship with the rest of the UK, or for example, we make sure that if you take decisions that damage the economy, then that has an impact on the amount that you have to spend, and to make sure that you do get rewarded for those positive, pro-business decisions. How you put that into legislation or practice is going to be a big issue, and I think that's where a lot of the debate is going to be between now and this coming into effect. And I'm not going to pretend there's an easy way to do it, but if we can do it, I believe that's a significant prize, and it will certainly enhance the decision-making process that takes place both here and indeed throughout Scotland.
Convener, on that point, do you think that we talk too much maybe about any creating any disadvantage where I suspect a lot of businesses who did support independence in Scotland saw that they were already disadvantaged and actually were seeking for a level playing field, and that the opportunity to have more powers through the Smith Commission would mean that we could actually make change, and that the argument is too much in these papers about maintaining, keeping everything the same?
I think we have to acknowledge the fact that when we asked the members, we did the biggest ever survey of small business opinion on this, and when we asked them about what are your, what your hopes, your aspirations and all the rest of it, yes, one of the things that came back was to say we could have a fiscal system, a regulatory regime that was specifically targeted towards the needs of Scottish businesses. But that was outweighed by those who said our biggest fear is having two different systems or multiple systems of regulation, employment law, taxation, etc. And that came through very, very strongly. That single UK market is something that our businesses really strongly were keen to preserve because they were worried about extra bureaucracy, etc. So I think, yes, while acknowledging that people aren't daft and they spotted opportunities, that was on balance outweighed by those who were who had spotted difficulties or were expressing concerns.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mark, to be followed by Richard.
Thank you, Convener. I'm always intrigued by the suggestion that there would, the implication that increased bureaucracy or introduction of new regimes for which businesses would have to make any adaptation, because huge numbers of businesses in Scotland are already located in more than one place. There are businesses who've got, who have ventures, either joint or their own ventures in other countries, and many of them are looking to expand internationally. So presumably, if the argument against devolution of certain fiscal measures was that it would create or the perception was it would create a bureaucracy which business would have to adapt to, that same argument would say that no business should ever seek to expand itself internationally. Would that not ring true?
Absolutely. No doubt. If you look at the feedback that we got from members, those who were already doing business internationally say, yeah, this is the sort of stuff that we deal with. Those who are doing business very locally said, well, how's this really going to affect me? The big group where there was concern was those who trade within the UK. And it was for them that they thought there was going to be, who had a lot of their customers across the UK. And when we asked just about where the markets were, the biggest group was those who did have suppliers and customers across the UK. So for them, this was going to be something new. So I mean, the example that we used at the time was I'm based in Glasgow, I'm down seeing customers in Manchester, I'm driving back up the M6, stopping at Southwaite Services to fill the car up. What do I do with the VAT receipt? It was those sorts of practical questions that people get that people think about. And for that type of business, it was they were the ones who tended to raise those questions the most.
Interested in perhaps the CBI and the Chamber's view, because obviously, I mean, I appreciate their, you know, I know a number of small businesses who do have international links, but perhaps the, you know, the CBI and Chambers have companies who are doing business in multiple jurisdictions across the world.
Majority, it's still fair to say the majority of our members don't trade internationally, and actually that notion about different rules and regulations in international markets is one of the key issues that prevents them in their own perception from trading internationally. So that's something that we need to try and overcome, because that is something that does prevent businesses from becoming more internationalised, and that's something we're actually speaking to one of the other committees in this Parliament about. So I think from the point of view of our members, the possibility of different, of being subject to different threats and different regulation and sets of regulation is something that they are naturally apprehensive about and would present a real cost to those businesses.
I'd agree with everything that Garry and Colin have said, and I think it's very easy to take each one of the powers and look at it in more detail and think, well, you know, there are certain things that businesses could do to make the administration of this more easy. It's when you start to think about the cumulative impact of all the changes that businesses, especially on the smaller and medium size, start to get their cages start to get a little bit rattled, and they think, well, what does it actually mean to, I have to set up a new payroll system as a result of changes to income tax. What happens on the VAT side of things? I'm a significant collector. What do I do with the receipts? It's that cumulative impact of all these changes that that sets businesses thinking about just what devolution actually means in terms of cost and administration. It's not each one individually, it's the cumulative impact.
Jean's touched on the areas around employment regulation, minimum wage. I'm curious as to the response that came from CBI around potentially putting businesses at competitive disadvantage, etc. I mean, are you suggesting that we've had a discussion about whether devolution of certain taxes would allow businesses perhaps to have a more competitive framework, and the response was that infrastructure around Scotland would be more advantageous. We now seem to be on the position that paying people a living wage might put businesses at a competitive disadvantage. I just wonder if you would care to outline which CBI members exactly can't afford to pay a living wage, given that there are many CBI members who have chief executive officers on six-figure salaries plus bonuses.
So, as I've already said, it's not for the CBI to mandate. It's not for the Scottish Government or the UK Government to mandate a living wage. We have a process for setting a minimum wage, which is based on evidence of economic trends and is therefore an affordable and sustainable way of setting a minimum wage. Where companies can afford to pay the living wage, they do. It varies by sector hugely. Gary's already alluded to the fact that in some sectors those marginal increases can mean the difference between taking on more people and laying people off. It's as simple as that. In some sectors, it's a lot easier to absorb those kind of rises. In others, it's not. And that's just the way it is, I'm afraid, that a huge increase in the minimum wage or the mandatory introduction of a living wage would have the impact of potential job losses in some sectors. I'm not saying it's across the board, but there are some sectors that are more sensitive to those kind of wage differentials.
What's your view on income tax devolution and the tax devolution proposals that the Smith Commission have come forward with?
Yeah.
I mean, you seem, I think we've gathered that CBI don't favour air passenger duty being devolved. What's your view in terms of devolution of powers over income tax that are proposed within Smith?
Sure. So on income tax, CBI members were a lot more relaxed, I have to say, about the prospect. They can see the driver for devolution of income tax in terms of narrowing that fiscal gap and increasing accountability, as has already been mentioned by the panel. There are just some very technical questions that remain unanswered about how this could work in practice. And certainly it's hoped that the draft legislation that's produced tomorrow will start to answer some of those questions, but I'm not sure that will be the case. Issues such as how income tax would then work in conjunction with national insurance contributions, for example, what it would mean in terms of PAYE systems, would it mean companies working across the border would have to set up separate payroll schemes, what would it mean in terms of enforcement, who would have jurisdiction over what, so HMRC, and what role they would continue to play. Quite technical questions about how this could work in practice, but very little negativity about the idea in itself.
From the Chambers and FSB in terms of income tax proposals, what's the view there?
We took a broadly neutral view on the devolution of further powers on income tax, largely because we already have a notional power over income tax, and further powers are being devolved will come into force next year in terms of the additional powers in the Scotland Act 2012. We don't yet know the full implications of that. Many businesses are prepared for it. Some are probably still unprepared for that. But most members are fairly relaxed about the prospect of the changes that are coming in anyway next year. In terms of what Smith has proposed, it's it goes beyond that clearly, but it doesn't necessarily complicate the issue too much more. I think what it does, and as Nicola has already said, it increases the revenues available to Scottish Government, which gives it more freedom in order to perhaps look at tax revenues more widely and revenues that are already and have been devolved for some time, such as business rates. But I think importantly, because income tax is now going to be one of the areas where the Scottish Government could derive a significant benefit in terms of overall revenue growth in Scotland, I think it does need to, the Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament more widely will need to look at policies on such issues as procurement, because clearly if a greater percentage of the procurement budget of public bodies across Scotland was spent domestically here in Scotland with Scottish businesses and more SMEs were involved in that, then we could be potentially increasing the revenues through income tax as a result, and I think that would be a good thing.
Well, I was just about to point out that you'd said it gives the opportunity for increased revenues. The only way you can increase revenues, well, there's two ways. It's one, you put income taxes up. The second is that you create more jobs within the economy. And I think you've given the answer to that. But and obviously procurement is something that's looked at very closely. And I appreciate it. I've not quite got to Colin's response yet, but perhaps this can build into it as well. Do you see job-creating powers within the basket of powers that are coming from? Are there powers that you could identify that are coming to Scotland that you would identify as these are powers that will help the Scottish Parliament to create jobs within the Scottish economy?
Well, businesses create jobs within the Scottish economy, and anything that helps businesses to do that is welcome.
Okay.
Yes, back to, as I said before, in the principle in terms of income tax, yes, we broadly support that. I think it makes sense, particularly when the Scottish Parliament already has responsibility for non-domestic rates, which are, of course, counter-cyclical with all the advantages and disadvantages that entails. So having a tax take that is more closely tied to the health of the economy got to be, you know, it sort of balances that out nicely, and we think is probably a positive move. Won't surprise you to learn that our chief focus, however, is on the practicalities, particularly for small employers. And I think, as we made clear in our Smith Commission, and as I've said repeatedly, we applaud the way that the, you know, the Scotland Office, the Scottish Government, you know, BIS, HMRC and the Treasury have taken forward the implementation of the 2012 Act. That has been, you know, I think, a model of how these things should be done. And in fact, even before Smith reported, we were saying, if you're going to, if this is what you're going to recommend, we would strongly advise that, you know, basically the continuation of that process. And I think in terms of, you know, not giving us separate tax returns to do, doing a lot of it through HMRC accredited software, putting the responsibility onto HMRC for determining who a Scottish taxpayer is, and, you know, and the liability, if, you know, it's not your liability as an employer, if you have an employee who's you know, pretending to live in one jurisdiction and and in fact is ordinarily resident in another. So the practicalities exactly of how we take this forward are going to be, I think, the focus of the debate in between now and its implementation. I think the 2012 Act will probably prove, you know, that, I mean, that's, compared to what Smith is proposing, quite a modest change, and it's taken us a long time to get here. And we're going to have another big job to do to communicate these changes and exactly what they mean to small employers. So I think the fact that that's happening is useful, because it means then it will be perhaps a, you know, a less of a big step to implement these changes as well. But I'm not pretending for a second it's going to be easy.
I think one would anticipate that the behind-the-scenes administrative changes required to move from Scottish rate of income tax to whatever comes from the Smith Commission would be done in that same spirit. If I can maybe just ask one final question, Cleaner, because I know you want to move on. We've talked a bit about what's there from Smith. We've talked about there are some things which I think have been identified, certainly from CBI, that we'd prefer were not there. Is there anything that's not there that you think should be there, or that your members would indicate should be there within the Smith proposals at present? Maybe we could start with Colin.
I mean, I think our view is that the politicians have come together. They've had, you know, the Commission itself has gathered evidence from across the country. The politicians have come together. They have done a deal, and our job now has to be focusing on implementing it and making it work. So rather than what's in it, what's not in it, not taking a massive interest, I think our focus has got to be on how do we implement this, in particular, how do we implement it so it's not to the, you know, the administrative and competitive disadvantage of particularly small employers in Scotland.
I'd agree with a lot of that. I think the only area where we would have liked to have seen something stronger was on the issue that we mentioned earlier about immigration. It is contained within the Smith Commission, and it's certainly an area we'll be working with the UK government very strongly to ensure that they do take that forward, because although it was mentioned within the Smith Commission, it's certainly not a proposal for devolution, and it's something we need to take forward with the UK government. But with the exception of that, I think I agree with everything that Colin has said.
Okay, and from the CBI perspective.
Thank you. I mean, certainly the view from our members is that, you know, what's on the table is quite an ambitious agenda. There are things that perhaps we might not want to see, but actually the focus now has to be on implementation and getting back to business as normal. The focus has to be giving business a little bit more certainty about the view going forward, and it's not the time to be thinking of new proposals to add to the basket.
Richard, to be followed by Gavin.
Thank you, Convener. Given that one of the proposals which has been floated before the Smith process was devolving corporation tax with a view to cutting it, it's perhaps a surprisingly lukewarm response in the submissions we've had from the panel, with CBI clearly not supporting that and the Chambers being neutral on it. I mean, Colin, you've not mentioned that specifically in the FSB submission, but is this another one of the areas where, at least for a sizable number of your members, the issue is, again, multiple systems? Does that lie behind the scepticism over that proposal?
It
Well, I mean, the first thing to remember is most of our members aren't incorporated, so don't pay corporation tax anyway. For us, the much bigger issue is round about personal taxation and income tax. Again, so that's where our focus in the process was, and there wasn't a great, again, surveyed the members on this.
So that general point you've put across, that cutting corporation tax would stimulate the Scottish economy, particularly giving it a competitive edge within the UK, that wasn't something that came out from your members as a general point about the economy, whether they actually were corporated or not?
No, the point was trying to get a bit, differentiate between whether or not you would devolve something to Scotland and what you would do with it once it was devolved. And we were very clear that we were going to leave that stuff at the door because, you know, we may have a government of a particular political complexion at the moment. That may change. We were trying to look for things for where could you say that taking a particular decision at a particular level would in itself be good for the Scottish economy, which is why we ended up saying, you know, things that are directly analogous to the health of the economy and economic growth was probably where the Smith Commission should concentrate its efforts.
I mean, those comments actually lead me on to my second question, which is around the more general issue about at which level decisions should be taken more broadly. Because obviously the Smith process, in terms of fiscal devolution, is focused principally on the dialogue between Westminster and Holyrood, and that's understandable, but clearly there's another important tier of decision-making as well, which is at a more local level, at a local authority level, empowering other local agencies too. I mean, have we had enough discussion, do you think, about what further powers could be devolved from this place, even at a more local level, in terms of the important decisions which can be made at that more local level, in terms of stimulating growth and business activity? I wonder if the Chambers would have any thoughts on that general debate, Garry.
Yeah, I mean, I think certainly looking back and touching on your first point as well about corporation tax, I mean, that's certainly an issue that we came back to a number of times from really I remember putting a report into this committee back in about 2011 prior to when the 2012 Act was kind of going through its initial stages. And returning to that with our members during the course of the referendum issue. And for our members, corporation tax was usually about the number three or four issue when it came to taxation. It was consistently outweighed by business rates and by income tax. Those are more important areas that they had identified for their business. And clearly, business rates usually comes out with our members as number one issue. It's an area that clearly has a local implication in terms of the way that rateable values are assessed and are charged. So for us, I mean, potentially that there's perhaps something in the debate about business rates that we could look at more local solutions. I mean, clearly the Scottish Government have been attempting to do that over the past few years with the local business rates incentivisation scheme, which is now in its, I think, second incarnation. And we're certainly hoping for more from that. Because clearly anything that we can do to stimulate local economies across Scotland, potentially utilising a tax which is rated by our members as the number one concern, may be an area for further local decision making.
Colin, do you have any further thoughts on that? I mean, obviously, in terms of the BRIS scheme, we've not actually seen that actually implemented in terms of operationally yet. So, but in terms of that general debate around local decision making, is there more for us to say?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at, you know, everything from planning, licensing, local roads, etc., etc. You know, I mean, local authorities are one of our members' biggest regulators, and you know, and actors on. their business. So I think, yes, it's probably a debate we should have been having for the last 15 years, probably, about the place of local government in Scotland and the fact that they are incredibly important to local economic development. And a number of people today have made the point about, you know, is it true that a rising tide lifts all boats, and why do some people get left behind, and, you know, and what is the issue there, and why hasn't that happened over the last, say, you know, 40 years? And I think we do have to look quite closely at local economies and how they work and how they don't work in some cases. And local authorities are going to have, you know, a real role to play there. I mean, they are now in charge. They take the lead on local economic development. But they have many other calls on their budgets and time. And I suppose it's the same sort of question that you can ask about what happens at a Scotland-wide level. How do you incentivise that local authority to take decisions which are in its long-term economic interest when there are so many other competing pressures? So there possibly is an argument in Briz for all its the challenges around that, and the legitimate questions around about business rates and how they work. There has to be a way of saying, if you take sensible long-term decisions which are in the interests of local people, local jobs, local businesses, etc., then you will be rewarded for that. And quite how we do that, I'm actually quite looking forward to some of the debates we're going to have round about Smith and the implementation of it. And I think is it section 95 of the report, but it talks about making sure how you do that adjustment to the block grant correctly and stuff. I think a lot of the things that we learn from that about additionality and baselining and all the rest of it will completely out with my sphere of expertise, such as I have to accept that I have one. I think that that's going to be very useful, and I think we're going to learn a lot from that we can then take those lessons and use them elsewhere, in particularly with local government.
Thank you.
Gavin, to follow by John.
Thanks. Firstly, when I've spoken to businesses in December and January, so post Smith reporting, the main message I'm getting from them is decisions have been made, Smith has reported, stop talking about what should or shouldn't be devolved and start getting on with implementing the decisions that have been taken. Is that roughly what your members are saying to you?
I mean, yeah, we've got, as I said before, the politicians have come together, they've got this deal. It looks, broadly sensible. The challenge now is to get on and implement it and focus on that. And if you ask our members what their priorities are for the year ahead, yes, confidence has taken a dip. Yes, there are worries about consumer confidence, but longer term, more of our members are talking about capital investment and making investments, etc. now. So we're looking forward to maybe a difficult start to the year, but quite a strong 2015. And I think that, bluntly, is where our members' attention is at the moment.
Okay. With that in mind, then, I mean, going through your submissions, the phrase balanced against administrative burdens comes up. Make sure you don't adversely affect business in what you do. So we know what Smith says, we know what is coming. In terms of the implementation of it, then, what are members saying to you about things that we really need to think about, avoid, or traps to be wary of? I mean, without getting overly technical, obviously there are some obstacles there, and there are other challenges that we will face, and we've heard some from this committee, but are there specific ones that you think ought to be highlighted that we start thinking about now?
In addition to what I'd said before about the income tax and how we do that and extending the 2012 principles, one of the interesting points to look at is VAT and the assignation of the 10 points of VAT. And it's a question that we've asked of the Treasury about whether or not it's VAT on a production or consumption. Is it the sales that I make here to people throughout the UK, or is it stuff that people here buy? Where is that sale made? Now, what we have been assured is that they're going to have some form of estimate of exactly what the Scottish VAT take is, and then take it from there. Again, the details of how that's going to work out, I imagine, will be subject to some pretty detailed negotiations. But we have been very clear that we do not want to be filling in a second VAT return. We do not want to be playing at private detective, running about the country, trying to find out where our customers are ordinarily resident. You saw some of the difficulties we had with some of the EU rules that came in the 1st of January about if you're doing online sales and finding out where your customers are within the EU. So all of that sort of those sorts of things, that's a sort of practical example that we need to avoid. I'm very pleased to say that when we made representations to the Treasury on this, they have assured us that that's absolutely not the intention, that this is going to be avoided. But as things move forward, that's the sort of thing we're going to be keeping an eye on.
Okay, just if we can stick with you just for a minute, Colin. I mean, you've made your VAT point, and it's the primary concern is about production or consumption and avoiding a kind of second return. In regards to other tax, I mean income tax or APD or anything else, are there any specific ones that you think ought to be highlighted at this stage?
In terms of income tax, my strong view would be to take the model that we've spent the last couple of years developing with the 2012 Act and what the work that we've done under that, and then extend that, particularly the user experience. It's a horrible phrase, but you know the how it looks from the small employers' end. I think we have to enshrine, keep those principles that we are not responsible for finding out who is and who isn't reading the legislation, and finding out under the ordinary residence test who is or who is not a Scottish taxpayer. That's got to be done by HMRC. Again, keep that. I don't see why we wouldn't. Ensure that the systems are collected by HMRC. We're not doing a Scottish separate tax return. Again, that's going to be done under the 2012 Act. I don't see any reason why we couldn't. So it's those sorts of things that we're looking at.
Okay, I'm grateful. I wonder if the CBI then could just, similar question, but what are your members saying to you about, they know what they know what's coming. Are there any specifics that they're concerned about or things they see as obstacles that we need to think about?
Sure, so certainly some of the implementation issues on VAT and income tax, Colin's already gone through. Other than that, on the APD side, certainly this issue of compensation for English airports or reimbursement that the Scottish Government might incur to the UK Government for switching off APD, which Smith alludes to. I think a lot of our members would be very interested to understand just how that might work. But certainly the issues that Colin's raised on VAT and income tax are the biggies.
Thank you. And same question to the Chamber of Commerce. Gary.
Yeah, but I think Colin summed it up very well. Certainly we spent a long time with largely UK government people in the wake of the 2012 Act, looking at the implications there for income tax and how payroll software, etc., would handle the changes. And there's been a sort of process where a lot of payroll software has been set up really back from 1999 and the Scottish variable rate. Taking on the 2012 Act, and we just need to make sure that businesses are well prepared and well set up to deal with all of the new changes when they come in over the next few years, starting next year. And I think importantly for us, I mean, we're obviously a Scottish business organisation, and most of our members are based in Scotland, but thinking as well about businesses based in other parts of the UK who will have employees who will be subject to this tax, and ensuring that their awareness levels are as high as they possibly can be in this. We've had some conversations with members about that who are based in other parts of the UK, have Scottish taxpayers on their payroll, and ensuring that they're able to smoothly integrate that into their systems.
Okay, thank you. Convener, grateful. Thanks.
Thanks, Gavin. John, to be followed by Malcolm.
Thanks very much, Convener. On corporation tax, I was interested in the CBI's comments on that because, on the one hand, you suggested you liked to have a level playing field and things to be as simple as possible, but you did also say that the UK having the lowest headline corporation tax in the G20 has sent a positive message abroad that the UK is open for business. I just wonder how you see that. I mean, a simple system would be one level of corporation tax for the whole of the EU, for example. But you seem to be, you quite like it if there's one regime has a lower rate than another?
Well, I think the important thing is that we make the UK as competitive as possible, and certainly having the lowest headline CT rate in the G20 helps to do that. In terms of simplicity, obviously the it's not a feasible assertion to suggest that we should have a single rate across the whole EU, and certainly we're talking about the UK and the powers that the UK government and the Scottish government might have. So I suggest that's probably an issue for another day. But certainly the strong message from our members is that they really value having a single tax CT regime within the UK. It's helpful from an inward investment point of view. Certainly the simplicity of having a single regime combined with having a very low headline rate is something that's very attractive. certainly thinking about our smaller and medium-sized businesses as well. They were very keen not to suddenly go from a UK-only firm to a, what is essentially an international firm overnight. If you start to implement different CT regimes within the UK, you would then be forcing those companies, if they're working across borders within the UK, to ultimately change their internal practices to mirror something like an international regime, and they felt that that was overly bureaucratic and a huge administrative ask.
Yeah, I mean, I take the point that we're not concentrating the EU, but I'm interested in the kind of logic, and you put a lot of emphasis on being evidence-based. But it would have seemed to me that the same evidence that said it's simpler for a company to have a one rate of corporation tax within the UK would also have said it's simpler to have it throughout the EU. I mean, have you done research with your members on that? Or?
Well, I think the key thing is that we're talking about UK firms being competitive vis-a-vis other European firms as well. So having a low headline rate in the UK is something that makes UK firms very competitive and something that makes the UK very attractive for inward investment from the EU as well. So
a member says that a Scottish company says that they would like to be more competitive because they had a lower rate of corporation tax. How does the CBI handle that?
Well, the CBI seeks views from across its whole membership. As I mentioned earlier on APD, there are always going to be issues where some of our members perhaps have different views from the majority, but certainly in terms of corporation tax, the majority of our members value having a single headline rate. And certainly, you know, the issue in Northern Ireland has brought this to the fore, where there are certain companies in Northern Ireland, CBI members, who have actively lobbied for a lower for the devolution of corporation tax in Northern Ireland because of the specific geographical challenges they face vis-a-vis the Republic. And certainly that's something where the view on the ground, the view of some Northern Ireland businesses, has stood in contrast to perhaps UK firms as a whole.
So, I mean, this report is headed up CBI Scotland. Is it the view of CBI just in Scotland, or is it the view of the CBI in the UK?
This was a submission that was pulled together, taking into account views from CBI Scotland, but certainly CBI UK members share that view.
Are there any issues where the CBI in Scotland and the CBI in the UK disagree?
I have to say, hand on heart, that no, there aren't.
So I might as well read CBI UK at the top of this paper.
Well, that's your choice, but it was pulled together, taking into account views from our CBI Scottish members.
I mean, I have to say, I find that very surprising that the CBI members in Scotland never take a different view from the UK, but there we go.
Never. Let me just clarify. In terms of the proposals that are on the table, in terms of what we're talking about, in terms of a Smith agenda, the views of our CBI Scotland members were aligned with that of the CBI UK.
Okay, thank you. I mean, on the kind of whole question of business taxation, the Chambers of Commerce does quite a lot on business rates. And I mean, I wonder if it's your feeling that the reason there's been a concentration of business rates is because the Scottish Parliament does not have, control of any other business taxes, especially corporation tax. So would it take the pressure off business rates if we had a kind of basket of taxes, including corporation tax, to play around with?
I certainly think that having additional revenue other than business rates may make it easier for the Scottish Government to be more flexible in terms of the operation of business rates in Scotland. As far as our members are concerned, I'm not even sure if all of them recognise that it is a devolved tax, so I'm not sure it's just because it's the only tax in the box as far as the Scottish Government's concerned that is why they're raising it. I don't think that at all, because we've raised it in the context of the referendum debate over the past 2 years and asked businesses what is your number one issue in this referendum debate, and consistently in terms of taxation it's been business rates. So whether there's a recognition that it currently sits with the Scottish Government or otherwise, I think it's fair to say that it is the number one issue for, for our members in terms of what they feed back to us. Corporation tax is further down the line. We've taken a neutral stance on it because we recognise that a number of our members are attracted by having the prospect of a lower rate of corporation tax in Scotland. Equally, though, it's a tax which doesn't affect all of our members by any manner of means. Business rates is far more applicable to more of our members. And in terms of the operation of corporation tax, we have had a number of representations along the lines that Nicola has suggested about the bureaucracy involved in apportionment of profits throughout the UK, which currently does not need to happen, and therefore there was a bureaucratic argument against devolution of corporation tax as well.
In principle, would your members prefer something like corporation tax, which is based on the profits they make, rather than something like rates, which is based on the property they hold?
I think in any holistic system of taxation, you're going to be tackling different aspects. So you're going to be tackling, I suppose, property because it's an easily targetable tax and it's an easily collected tax. You're also going to be looking at things like profitability as well. And I think for personal taxation and for business taxation, any basket of taxes will target different areas of operation and resource. So I think the complication, I suppose, we have is that with the devolved settlement, we've clearly got property tax sitting in one place and profit taxes sitting somewhere else. But looking at what Smith has proposed, I think certainly from our members' point of view, we're certainly looking at the revenue side and thinking, well, that may allow the Scottish Government to do more with business rates than it's been able to thus far, because clearly looking at the prospect of reduced corporation tax on one hand and looking at the actuality of a 28% increase in business rates since the last revaluation in 2010, there needs to be something of a rebalancing of business rates.
And Mr. Borland, is that less of an issue for you because you said quite a lot of your members are only paying income tax, so the corporation tax wouldn't have such a big impact?
Yeah, that's correct. The majority of our members are not incorporated, so therefore it's not an issue. And I think, the reason why that we focus on income tax as well and things like VAT is just, as I said again, it's about those taxes which are sort of are a good sort of yardstick for the health of the economy. And while we don't set ourselves up as amateur economists, there is an argument that corporation tax take is not quite as directly tied to the health of the economy, or rather your indigenous business base, as perhaps things like VAT and personal income tax.
Would you members prefer to be taxed on the profits or the properties, or to just accept it's both, like Mr. Clark said?
I think they accept the reality of the tax regime. I think, though, when you're thinking about corporation tax vis-a-vis business rates, you also have to think about the mobility of that tax base. Obviously, with business rates, the tax base isn't quite as mobile. And when you're talking about devolution, you have to think about what you're actually seeking to achieve, what you're actually seeking to do, if you're hoping to drive inward investment or not. Businesses, to be honest, will pay the tax that they are required to pay.
Okay. Mr. Borland?
Follow up on the specific point about business taxation in general. I mean, I think, you're absolutely right that we need a system of business taxation which reflects how we do business now in 2015. And there are issues, you wouldn't want to exclude property from it because of the issues about mobility. At the same time, how do you make sure that it reflects one's turnover, profitability, ability to pay and all the rest of it? And I do wonder whether now that, should these proposals come to fruition and you have sort of both sides of the house, if you like, you have that stable counter-cyclical property-based tax, tax base there, along with the side that's, directly linked to the health of the economy, then having both of them, under the one roof might make it easier to have that debate about how we sort of move forward and reform what I think everyone's agreed is a system which might be the least worst option at the moment, but probably doesn't reflect the sort of economy and the way we do business today.
I mean, Mr. Baker asked you before, and you commented about the whole local, you know, further devolution down the way kind of thing. I mean, would you be relaxed if there were 32 different business rates throughout Scotland if we, say, stopped planning appeals and all the planning decisions were made entirely at local level, all the licensing was decided at local level? I mean, would that be a direction you'd be comfortable to go in?
That's exactly the sort of stuff that we're going to be looking at in a lot of detail in the next year, 18 months. We don't have a position on those specific points, but the sort of thing that you're talking about saying that, you know, you are responsible for this level of, you know, you're involved with economic development, so therefore you have to be taking these decisions in a way that generates economic growth, and you will see the benefits of that, or indeed you'll see the detriment if you take the, you know, if you take the wrong decisions, is a principle that we are attracted to. And I think there's an awful lot that we can begin to explore there about exactly what you want to do, with the obvious caveat that we don't need to see 32 different sets of rules about essentially the same thing. You know, we have, obviously, you know, we have the work that's been done here on better regulation and how we harmonise that. The Better Regulation Act was, you know, I think, you know, a significant and, you know, unheralded piece of legislation that was passed here. So with that obvious caveat, I think that's something that, if we're going to look at how we regenerate these economies, which no matter what we've done, whether it's chasing foreign direct investment or whatever for the last, you know, 30, 40 years, hasn't really worked.
Okay, thank you. We've spent quite a lot of time, and I don't want to spend much more on it, on the minimum wage in that area. And, I mean, is it the case, you are all speaking as employers' organisations, and I totally accept that, although I accept, I suppose, small business may not have any employees. Do you only look at a question like that from the point of view of, can the business afford this, or do you also look at the point of view of, can the person afford to live on this wage?
You know, I mean, particularly for small businesses, you know, our health is intrinsically linked to the health of the local economy. At the end of the day, though, we have to keep the lights on, a roof over our head, and make sure that the numbers add up. It's interesting, in the earlier discussion, you know, about wage rates and what's happening there, you know, it's something that we do take seriously. And when you look at other input costs in businesses at the moment are on their way down, for, you know, global prices and all the rest of it, the issues that we know a lot about. One of the key drivers of increasing costs at the moment is in staff costs. Staff costs are increasing even if headcount necessarily isn't, which suggests to us that, you know, we are doing our best to pass on savings whenever we possibly can. I would again reiterate the fact that we applaud the work of the Low Pay Commission. I think it has been a success. It's taking politics completely out of the process. Whether or not we want to, you know, something like that should be devolved to Scotland, you know, or indeed regionally, or, you know, or whatever, is something that I think, you know, you could certainly argue.
Process? You mean it's taking the politicians out of the process? Do you?
Well, I think, yeah. I mean, rather than, for example, the Chancellor of the Exchequer, or indeed the Scottish Finance Secretary, standing up and saying, right, today I'm going to bump up the minimum wage to this level. It's, you know, evidence-based. It's taking, you know, here's some employers, here's some sectors, and it, you know, and it is...
When you say it's evidence-based, is it evidence-based on what people can live on, or just evidence-based on what businesses can afford to pay?
Its statutory duty is to set the wage at the highest possible level without affecting job numbers.
Mm-hmm. So it doesn't take account of whether people could live on it or not?
No. However, the obvious thing to do, if you reduce the cost of employment, then of course then that number is going to increase. And if you look at the direction of travel, with things like, you know, the £2,000 employer's allowance and national insurance reduction and stuff like that, that seems to be the road that we're going down, and that's one that obviously we're very comfortable with, because the more savings we get, you know, the more affordable it is to employ people, and the higher that number can be.
Thanks. I mean, Mr. Clark, do you have a view on that? I mean, are you speaking for the employers, really, and not taking account what the employees think?
Well, clearly, we're a membership organisation, and we speak principally on behalf of our members. I mean, I think, though, there is a wider issue in terms of some of the issues that we touched upon earlier, that clearly where you've got an economy which is over the past couple of years been driven principally by consumer demand, then the economic health of those consumers is important to businesses as well, because where the economy is driven by consumer demand, as I mentioned earlier, and you've got real wages falling, then that, you know, creates a tension which you know could make the economic recovery unsustainable. It is one of the reasons why I'm very pleased that, you know, our recent surveys have shown that businesses are increasing investment, and actually we've noticed a dip in productivity, and the dip in productivity has been due to businesses investing in training of their staff in many cases. And that's, I think, very healthy, because that training will make staff more productive, and more productive staff will be able to generate more revenue for that business, and ultimately will hopefully see their wage levels increase. And as I say, we've detected some pretty broadly based increases in wages over the past quarter, and that's, I think, very positive for our economy and for our society.
Okay, thanks. And finally, Ms. Walker, I mean, when you've used terms like affordable, like economic, mm-hmm. before this morning.
Yes.
Do you always use these words from an employer's point of view?
So certainly, similarly to Garry, the CBI is an employer's organisation. We are a membership organisation, and it's our job to represent our members' interests, but equally they don't sit in isolation. And certainly the Low Pay Commission does take an evidence-based approach. It certainly considers issues like inflation trends as well, so thinking about whether or not you know, employees can live on the minimum wage that is suggested.
Do they take that into account, actually? Yes.
They do, yes. Right. Yeah. But certainly from our members' perspective, it is about what employers can afford, but it is about what employees can live on as well, in the sense that members have been very supportive, for example, of changes over recent years to, for example, the increase in personal allowance. They've been very keen to call for reductions in employee NICS contributions to ensure that actually employees are taking home more of that pay, but also very keen to focus on, as Garry alluded to as well, creating good sustainable career paths so that people actually move off the minimum wage, investing in training, investing in upskilling their workforce, so that people are not likely to spend their whole working lives on the minimum wage, but actually see a career path within these companies.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And Malcolm?
I think we've covered the various fiscal powers pretty comprehensively, and you all seem broadly supportive of Smith, so I've really just got a question about what other changes you think need to take place for the successful implementation of Smith. The Chambers of Commerce make the interesting suggestion that the committees have got to improve their performance. Perhaps he would like to comment on how that would help the implementation of Smith, or perhaps he wouldn't. But I suppose the other issue I have in mind is the whole role of the Fiscal Commission, and whether you think that needs to be developed as we have more fiscal powers within the Parliament.
I suppose kicking off on that one, I think certainly the processes that Smith has outlined in terms of the necessary engagement that will need to take place between Scottish Government and UK Government to work out, you know, all of these principles that we've considered earlier in terms of you know, what the knock-on effect of doing you know, increasing tax here or increasing spending here or reducing tax here or reducing spending here will have on the overall UK economy, and what will flow back to the Scottish Government as a result of that. I think that process is going to need a huge amount of cooperation and understanding between the Scottish and UK governments, because if that doesn't take place, and if the relations between the government aren't as between the two governments are not as as effective as they might be, then it's potentially a recipe for disaster and conflict. But I think where the two governments are working together and are working hand in hand to ensure that we know as far as possible what the outcomes of any changes to legislation in Scotland will be, then I think it's potentially got a lot of a lot of benefit to be had in terms of how we can make changes in Scotland that will increase the ability of our businesses to compete and increase the overall economic strength of our economy. I think in terms of the committee system in the Scottish Parliament, I think it does need to step up to its game, because I think there'll be a lot more detailed scrutiny that will need to take place of any measures, because I think the considerations will be far wider than they have been in the past 15, 16 years.
Well, I always think the committees are absolutely wonderful. But I would agree with, you know, what Garry says is absolutely right. You know, there's some of this that's going to be in the face of the bill, there's some of it we can do under subordinate legislation, there's an awful lot of it that's going to rely on proper cooperation and communication and agreements between, whether that's a memorandum of understanding or however you want to do it, between Holyrood and Whitehall. And because, again, to underline what Garry said, we can't have a situation where we get to, like, every autumn statement that there's a row about what the tax take might have been or might not have been and how much the block grant should be reduced, etc., etc. We need to know how that's done, and we need to get that agreed so that we can, so you can plan how you know what money you have to spend and how that should be spent, but also so we have a better idea of, you know, what tax rates are going to be and any other obligations that are going to be placed on us.
Yeah, absolutely agree with that. Clear view from CVI members that they want to see, or they want to avoid, a duplication of approach and coherent policy making. Agree with everything that Garry and Colin have said. The two particular relationships that have interested our members the most is the relationship between the Scottish Fiscal Commission and the OBR, for example, in terms of ongoing work on fiscal consolidation, but also between Revenue Scotland and the HMRC, and just ensuring that actually our tax making or tax implementation powers there are joined up.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, well, that's exhausted questions from the committee. Just before we conclude, I wonder if there's any further points any of our witnesses would like to make to the committee. No? Okay, well, I'd like to thank you very much for answering all our questions, and from colleagues for putting those questions. I'm now going to call a recess until 11:20 to allow a changeover of witnesses and to give members a natural break. Reconvene the session and we will continue our consideration of further fiscal devolution by taking evidence from Edward Troup and Sarah Walker of Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs, members of copies of a briefing note and a progress update provided by HMRC. Before we go to questions, I would like to welcome both our guests to the committee and invite one of them to make a short opening statement.
Thank you and good morning, convener. It's very good to be here again.
Yeah.
And since I've been here, obviously, since I was here last, quite a lot of activity has been going on, and you've got the report from us. As ever, we're very focused on delivering the provisions of the Scotland Act 2012, for which we're responsible, particularly the Scottish rate of income tax and relationships with our colleagues in Scottish Government. Revenue Scotland remain very good, and we're very happy with the progress that is being made on that. And obviously, we're concerned about that because we want a good delivery of the project itself, but also, depending on what happens with the proposals in the Smith Commission, we may find ourselves involved in further implementation, and therefore getting this right is setting the scene and is indeed going to teach us lessons which hopefully we will come to use in future years as and when Smith proposals become law.
Thank you very much, and you may have noticed there's been a few changes to the committee since you were last here. Okay, well, you know the drill, basically. I'll ask some opening questions, and then, of course, we'll go around the table. The first thing I want to talk to you about is basically thinking about your report way back in May of last year, stated that we will not have a quote from our IT suppliers from the IT changes until later this year, so we have specified as close as we can the non-IT elements. But the submission doesn't actually make any reference to the quote from IT suppliers that was expected later this year, your most recent submission. Just wondering where we are with that.
You're referring to our IT supplier and,
yes,
and the work we need to do to prepare for it. I think I will probably hand over, and I hope I will spend not too much of this hearing handing over to Sarah, who you've seen before, but is responsible for the practicalities of the programme, is a lot closer to the facts of this than I am. So, Sarah, can you answer that one?
Yes, indeed. We have been talking with our IT supplier. We have clear estimates for parts of the work. That we will publish updated estimates of the overall cost in the next annual report, which we will be producing before the general election, so it'll be a little bit earlier this year. The IT delivery is split between changes to our mainframe systems for PAYE and self-assessment, also changes to our digital systems, which will allow taxpayers to access details of their tax affairs online, and also a separate element, which is about making sure we make the right changes to the systems that we have dealing with returns from the pension schemes for relief at source pension contributions. So it's quite a complex area of different parts of IT implementation, not all of which are part of the main IT supply arrangements. We're still confident that it's within that range of 10 to 15 million, and we will give a new estimate in the next annual report.
I mean, that was actually, you've almost preempted my next question, because the report did say it would be higher than the previous 10 million estimate, although below 15, and I was just going to ask you if you did any indicative information with regard to how close to 10 million it might be as opposed to 15 million.
I think I'd prefer not to give a figure at this stage, but there will be a figure in the next annual report.
So it could really be anything from 10.1 to 14.9 then, really, potentially.
Yes.
Okay. Right, let's talk about the accuracy of the address data. In May, HMRC said we're still working on it, and the written submission says that HMRC is continuing to develop the approach to identifying Scottish taxpayers, and this will be finalised over the next few months. But in December, you know, there was a press report which stated that and I quote, HMRC risk register in October which has been released under Freedom of Information, has issued a red alert warning when it comes to identifying Scottish taxpayers. And the HM Revenue and Customs tables reveal that identifying taxpayers has been moved from an amber warning in January to red alert over the summer, where it remains. And, of course, we have actually this table between amber and red list. And as I recall, Gavin asked a number of questions on what that meant specifically, but certainly in terms of this issue, there are concerns. I'm just wondering if you can tell us where we are with that.
You used the word red alert. I think I'd slightly push back on the use of the word alert. I mean, we're using a well-developed and familiar risk management framework where looking at particular issues by reference both to the magnitude of their potential impact on the programme and the probability of them happening, we assign them a red, amber or green level, which helps us, as it does with any programme manager, focus resources and activities. And the fact that something is green clearly doesn't mean when we're not looking at it, it just means that it doesn't need the immediate attention which something which is red. And I think picking up that point about the rating for particular items being a combination of impact and probability, you could have something which was a relatively low impact on the project but was moderately likely to happen, which could end up with amber or possibly even green. What we have here on the issue of identification of the Scottish taxpayer population is something which, if we don't do it right, if we don't get a high level of accuracy of identification, it would have a significant impact on the whole project. So it's a high impact element. Actually, we don't think that the probability is particularly high, but looking at the probability and the impact together, it does take it into an overall risk measurement of 18, which is in the red zone and making it a red risk. So that's the background, and I would distinguish between the rating given to individual risks within this and our view of the programme as a whole, because the programme as a whole we do regard as very much on track, and we are confident that the SRIT will be delivered on schedule in April 16. And having one or more red items within a risk register is entirely normal. And indeed, I think it's, in a sense, reassuring because it shows that we are actually focusing continuously on those areas where we do need to put resources. So far as the specific risk is concerned, and I gave it evidence to the Treasury Committee of the UK Parliament on this before Christmas, we do not, as I think I can't remember if I've told this committee, have the power to compel people to give us their names and to notify us of changes of address. So we cannot be completely confident that our register of names and addresses is 100% accurate. We cannot be confident that our programme of communication and publicity over the course of this year will tease out all of those individuals whose addresses have changed. So we have been looking, and it is those risks which effectively are reflected in this. So we have been looking at the potential use of third-party data to calibrate against our data in order to identify individuals where there is a mismatch between our record of their addresses and other data sources in order to improve the accuracy of the overall database. And that effectively is the mitigating action for this risk. Since this risk register was prepared, we have made progress. And I think Sarah may want to say a little bit about where we've got to, because it literally is in the last couple of days in progress on working on electoral register as a third-party source of data. Do you want to say just roughly where we've got to reassure the committee, Sarah?
Yes, of course. We have all along recognised the need to supplement the address data that we have with external sources, if we possibly could, as Edward said. And we have decided in the next, in the last few days, to use the electoral register as a reference point to and do a major exercise to scan our existing address database for the whole of the UK against addresses that, of people who appear on the electoral register in Scotland. That will give us a good estimate of the accuracy of our addresses, and also give us a potential list of people who do live in Scotland but aren't on, don't have a Scottish address on our system. So that's going to give us an additional level of assurance. That's on top of the basic proposal, which is that we will write to all the people we currently think are living in Scotland, and we will conduct quite an extensive publicity campaign in Scotland to make sure that people realise if they don't get a letter from us and they do live in Scotland, that they ought to be making sure that we have their up-to-date address.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, just sticking with this Amber Green thing, just a wee second, and I've heard all Mr. Troop said on that, you know, the last time you were here, you said Amber Green is about as good as we can get. In effect, it says the project is going well, and I understand what you've said about focus. But the forecast is that 6 of the 13 will still be on Amber, and one would have thought that the forecast would be for all 13 to be on Green.
I think I'd go back and make the point that the fact that there are some ambers within this, and again, I think we wouldn't, the risk register wouldn't be doing its job if everything was on green, because you know, in any project involving you know systems, people, stakeholders, communication, and obviously you know a lot of taxpayers, there are always going to be issues that. The overall project, I am confident, will be delivered, and this is not in any way saying it's not, but I'm trying to pick out one of the amber ones by way of example, and there's a risk I'll pick the wrong one, but I'm just looking down the list. Let's take the second one, actually, the first amber one on the list. There is a risk that the project team has insufficient controls to manage costs, which may result in final costs exceeding budget tolerances. Now, I would be very unhappy if we came back at some point and effectively had exceeded a budget tolerance, and that's something which we are seeking to manage. But I think you can see from that, that is not prejudicing the project as a whole. I am confident that we will manage that down. I'm confident we will get there. But if we ended up with that one still at amber at the end, it wouldn't in any way say that we were not delivering on this project and getting it right. It would say that on one element of it, managing our costs within our tolerances, we had not got to where we wanted to. Now, as I say, I'm confident we will. But I just picked that example because it shows that you know I don't think I can sit here and say that I can say that by the time we get to March 31st, all of these ambers will be green. It would be an unusual project that it were. But we are working hard to get them all as green as possible.
Okay, thank you. Gavin, want to come in on this point?
Just on that, thanks. On that forecast point, just so I can get a better understanding, what is the word forecast actually mean in terms of time? Is this forecast for the next monthly report or the next quarterly report? I'm assuming it's not a forecast for April 2016. So is there a kind of time frame?
Well, each of the risks has a time frame relevant to the particular risk. So that the issue of identification effectively remains a risk down to the point in which we have identified taxpayers, but I would hope that we will manage it to green well before that. Some of them are shorter-term risks because they're ones which relate to elements of the programme which are on a shorter timescale, or the actual risk itself, that, you know, there isn't a recruitment risk here, that we haven't, you know, recruited the right people, might be a matter of days or even weeks. So this is, in a sense, not a time, this is not a forecast over a period, it is a statement in terms, in relation to each of the risks, each of the issues which we have identified as being relevant to this programme and which we need to make sure are delivered and delivered accurately and well in order to get to the overall delivery of the Scottish rate.
Okay. I'm going to open up the session now to colleagues around the table. First person to ask questions will be Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Gavin. Just to stick on this issue to begin with, I mean, we've had discussion recently about risk registers and identification of risk. And I think you've pointed out that there is a combination of probability and impact, and often it's the impact that tends to be the higher score on our risk register, or you would hope impact is the thing that would be the higher score on the risk register. So presumably, when you're looking at the forecasts here, presumably what you're looking at is managing down probability, but impact, I would imagine, is going to remain fairly static on most of these. I mean, if something is a high-impact risk now, it will remain a high-impact risk, but it's the probability is the element that you're looking to manage. Would that be a fair assessment?
That's right. And I think if you read this risk register closely against the previous one, I think there are one or two risks that we've actually taken off, because effectively we think we have exercised the controls we needed to eliminate it as a risk. But in a sense, they remain there in the background, but they are not at a sufficient level that they need any degree of active control, which is what's needed once something makes it to the risk register. But yes, the impact of all sorts of factors remains whatever it is, so long as the issue is there.
Yeah. And this is not just a commentary on this, but you know, many of the risk registers that I've seen over time have the same issue, is that there's not that disaggregation between probability and impact. And so somebody looking at this and looking at a risk score of 18 would assume that that's something that is, you know, has a high risk of happening. It may be that the high risk is the impact if it does happen, rather than the likelihood of it happening. And there's maybe not the information contained within that register, if it's being released as it has been, as an FOI response, to make clear the distinction.
I think that's entirely right. I'm not sure if you were implying that you wanted a greater degree of disaggregation in what we release. And while I come here to be as helpful as I can to the committee, there's obviously a point that we cannot expose the sort of every day-to-day working of how the teams work and what's going on. It just would completely get in the way of effective working. But if there are specific issues where you feel that actually more information is needed, then I'm happy to look at the scope for sharing those. But yeah, you know, you will appreciate that just as a general matter, we share our sort of high-level risks where we can, and there aren't sensitivities, but we don't expose all of the day-to-day details of everything that goes on in the department.
I appreciate that, and you know, I wouldn't seek to speak for the committee, but from looking at it from the perspective of just looking at the scoring, I think understanding where these are in terms of the probability versus impact, I think, would be very helpful, because looking at a red score at the moment, my interest would be, is that a red score because it is likely to happen, rather than it's a red score because if it did happen, there would be a significant impact. So perhaps an explanatory note might be a means to go forward, but I'll leave that. It's maybe something the committee can discuss.
I'm happy to say on that specific one, and it is red, and you've rightly drawn attention to it, that is a high impact and a medium probability at the moment. And, you know, our view is that is going to come down over the next, you know, really the next month or two, because the work which Sarah's talked about actually is already giving us comfort that we are going to manage down the probability of there being a significant misalignment on our Scottish taxpayer register, you know, to a low level. So I'm happy to give a further note, but in a sense, I'm just happy to tell you that, and I suspect a note wouldn't say much more than what I've just said.
I know, obviously, the work that is ongoing just now is in relation to the 2012 legislation and the powers that will come from that. We are obviously in a situation where, and we don't know what the final legislation will look like. I think we're going to get the draft clauses are going to be published this week, so
yesterday to the Select Committee, it would be tomorrow.
So there will be some indication of what is likely to come. Given the timescale that's been involved in the implementation of the 2012 legislation, what do you see going forward when the further taxation powers, whatever those are, come forward in terms of timescale? Do you think it's going to be roughly similar timescale we're going to be looking at, or does this give you a much stronger platform to build on to implement those, and they could potentially be done within a much shorter timescale?
I'm obviously not going to speculate too much about what's going to happen legislatively, and there's a degree of hypothetical question in that, which is, you know, what would happen, what would we do if the Smith provisions were legislated in broadly the form agreed. I mean, clearly what we have done on the Scottish rate is going to be a firm platform for the further Smith proposals on income tax, because, you know, as we've just been discussing, as you've seen, a large part of this is setting up the identification of Scottish taxpayers and setting up our system so they recognise Scottish taxpayers and setting up the payroll capability to allow for a differential rate for Scottish taxpayers than English taxpayers. So, yes, the implementation of changes within Smith, which make further changes to rates and bands, would be easier, will definitely be easier, and hence more you know, able to be introduced more quickly than the careful lead-in time we've had with these provisions. I wouldn't want to say how quickly. As always, the constraining system, the constraining factors tend to be around systems. The self-assessment returns, and I know this does sound, you know, slightly mad, but the fact is that we have more or less finalised the self-assessment returns for the year 15-16 with the IT suppliers, so which implies that SA changes, you know, do take 15 months or more to bring in, and that in itself is a constraint on change. That's not to say that, you know, some changes can't be introduced more quickly, and it's not to say that there cannot be some messy ways of working around our constraints. I think, in a sense, by the time we get to a point of legislating Smith, we will have a clearer sense of what other actions are required. The Chancellor made it clear yesterday that sorting out the fiscal position and the block grant adjustment would be a major factor. I hope that HMRC systems constraints and our requirements will not get in the way of this delivery to the political timetable, but I certainly agree with the proposition. It will be easier to do. It will be able to do this more quickly than we have with these provisions.
You spoke about the systems that are being put in place, and that's sort of where I was going to go with it, with my final question. Are you confident enough that the systems that you are implementing now, both in terms of the IT, but also in terms of, you know, how you monitor and ensure essentially the accuracy of the data that you have, will be in a position to adapt to any new system that is put, a new taxation framework that is put in place as a result of Smith? I mean, I realise, you know, it's asking you to pin a tail on a donkey, essentially, because we don't know where we're going to be in terms of exactly what the legislation says. But are you confident that there's flexibility there? Because I think if you're having this expenditure on new IT systems and other things like that, are we in a position where that is going to be adaptable, or are we in a position where in a couple of years' time you're going to be unplugging it all and putting something new in?
I hope not. I mean, it's not for me to ask questions, but I would ask you and your political colleagues in Westminster, are you confident that the provisions are going to be implemented as they are in the legislation? And, you know, there is always the uncertainty of what happens when legislators get to grips with the details of legislation. I think in terms of what is in Smith, particularly in relation to income tax, within the bounds of what might reasonably be done with that in terms of changing rates within, you know, the basic and higher rate, not creating sort of 25 different tax bands, I think I would be confident that, yes, our systems will cope, can cope with that, and we can implement without, you know, having to, as you say, tear up or you know, unplug all of our existing systems and starting again.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Malcolm.
Thanks, Convener. Can I ask, these tables that we have are taken from your overall risk register. Am I right in saying that not all the risks are on these tables?
No, as when we disclosed the previous version, we did make some small amount of redactions in relation to risks which relate to commercial and third-party arrangements within the terms of the FOI exclusions, which allow us to do so where disclosure of the risks would prejudice you know, our ability to deal with those third parties. And obviously, I'd rather not sort of go into details of that, but what I would sort of reassure this committee is that, first of all, I'd repeat what I said before, that I'm quite confident overall this project will be delivered. And without going into the small number of risks that have been redacted, I don't think you would find anything there which would cause you concern. And I think, in a sense, picking up Mr. McDonald's point, my recollection is that those risks are ones which are not high impact risks, but they are ones where we are concerned about probability at the moment. Is that right? Perhaps I should hold on that. So put a slight caveat over whether I've got that right in the record.
Okay. I mean, can you tell us anything about the system? Is there a committee within HMRC that looks at the full risk register
There is, as you know, an extensive governance process over the whole of the implementation of this. We have our internal programme board, which Sarah sits on for us, with representatives of the Treasury. And we also have the board above that with representatives of Revenue Scotland, the Treasury and ourselves, and then above that the Ministerial Committee. And within that structure, the risk registers are looked at, and our internal boards with the Treasury do go through the risk registers in detail and would flag up to the board working with Revenue Scotland any material issues which are going to get in the way of implementation.
Okay, thank you. Now, I'm not sure if this is entirely your area, but so correct me if I'm straying off limits, but I mean, the whole timing of tax coming in, obviously traditional stamp duty land tax, it doesn't all come in the year of the tax. It comes in presumably gradually over the months that follow, as with all taxes. Is that something you're involved in or measuring?
Well,
or anything?
I mean, I think I may be able to help you. I'm not quite sure what the question is. I mean, stamp duty land tax actually is a more real-time tax than, for instance, self-assessment.
So I've strayed myself. I've got myself confused here, I think. I'm meaning still with income tax specifically, yes. I mean, it comes in gradually over time. So is that something you measure as to how much comes in a particular year or how much comes in other years?
Yes, we have our colleagues in the Knowledge Analysis and Intelligence Directorate, KAI, who effectively monitor flows. Obviously, we monitor revenue flows for a whole variety of reasons. First and foremost, we monitor them because our colleagues in Her Majesty's Treasury are quite keen to know how much cash comes in, and we report monthly. In fact, December's figures are going to be published tomorrow. But we obviously monitor that for our own internal purposes, for management purposes, because a lot of our activity is devoted to compliance work. That is to say, to achieving tax payments which would not have taken place without our intervention, and understanding what tax is coming in through our compliance intervention work is very important to measuring our own performance. And obviously, we measure it because it gives us useful data about what's going on with the economy and what's going on with the tax system, and gives us broader management information. So, yes, we do measure that. We forecast it. The published forecasts are signed off by the Office of Budget Responsibility, but we, you know, do most of the sort of legwork on forecasting and analysis is done internally within HMRC.
Okay, I think that's fine. Thanks.
Okay, Malcolm?
I think you said that you couldn't compel taxpayers to tell you of the change of address. So is that the only issue? I mean, do you know the addresses of everyone who pays tax, but you just don't know when they change their address, or do you not actually know the address of everyone who pays tax?
I'll let Sarah speak to the details. I certainly would not say we know everybody's name and address. There are people, obviously, who deliberately choose to be outside the tax system. There are people who, for whatever reason, have just failed to update their information. And there are people who change addresses for reasons nothing to do with tax and don't want anybody to know, you know, either some sort of marital dispute, creditors or whatever. So at any point in time, we absolutely are not at the position we are 100% sure that we have everybody's names and addresses accurately. We're not 100% sure we know who everybody is. I mean, there are what we refer to as ghosts within the hidden economy, individuals who effectively just stay off the radar, and there are people who we do know about whose affairs are chaotic, either accidentally or, or deliberately. So, you know, that's just the inevitability of dealing with, you know, tens of millions of individuals. Sarah may want to say something about, you know, what we do know and what we've how we verify.
We have an address with a proper postcode for, I think, over 98% of taxpayers. What we don't know is whether that is an up-to-date address. Those are the addresses we use for correspondence. So if we need to send somebody a tax code notice or something like that, we have an address that we send it that we send that to. But there will be examples, for instance, where people have left home but still have things sent to their parents' address and they go and pick it up whenever they go home. So there'll be all sorts of perfectly good reasons why they haven't bothered to give us their current address because they can still get post from us. This will be the first time when your tax status has actually depended on where you live, and so it makes it more important for us to be clear that the person is actually living at the address that we're talking that we have on our system, and we will need to know the date when they move because Scottish taxpayer status depends on where you've lived for the majority of the year. So the date within the year when you change address will often be relevant to Scottish taxpayer status.
Okay, that's very helpful. The second thing I really wanted to ask you was about the prediction of income tax receipts. So, my understanding is you have quite an important role in relation to this with the OBR. Could you say something about that?
Yes. As I said, our knowledge and analysis and intelligence unit do the work. They collect the data and have access to all HMRC data. And from that, they will both measure what's happening and will make forecasts of what is going to happen. Since 2010, when the Office of Budget Responsibility was created, the formal forecasts of revenues and public finances and indeed of the economy have moved from the Treasury to the OBR. And so at the two forecasts of the year, one in the autumn statement and one at the budget, the OBR will engage very closely with our colleagues in order to put together what are, in fact, our OBR forecasts, but are based in terms of the underlying data almost entirely on material which we provide to them. And I don't think the OBR has been praised for its independence, in a sense the process from our perspective feels very much the same as when it was the Treasury who was doing the forecasting, when we would have the same conversation with colleagues in the Treasury before those events and the Treasury would then forecast. So, but in both cases, you know, then and now, it is we, HMRC, who provide the underlying data and the first cut of the forecasts for discussion.
And would there be a problem from your point of view if you were doing that work with a Scottish body, the Fiscal Commission, developing its role in relation to income tax?
I mean, we currently do forecast the shares of revenue, the various revenues for Scotland, and we have in the last year published a breakdown of both past receipts and forecasts on a basis for all four devolved administrations and areas of the UK. I'm not quite sure, you know, what your question is in terms of would we be prepared to discuss forecasts with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, to which I think the answer would be yes. Would we be willing to do forecasts for the Scottish Fiscal Commission? It's a slightly different question, which, you know, in a sense I wouldn't want to say no, but I don't think we would have any obligation to provide forecasts for them at the moment.
Cast for the different parts of the United Kingdom. Is that what you said?
Yes,
that,
we do. We do. We have.
Is that something that comes out via the OBR, or do you do those on?
The OBR forecasts Scottish devolved taxes.
Based on what you.
Based on our work.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. And just to follow on from Malcolm's question, do you also do forecasting for stamp duty land tax?
Yes, absolutely. Yes. I mean, we forecast, you know, all revenues.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. That appears to have concluded the questions from members of the committee. Are there any further points you want to make before we wind up?
No, I don't think so. I'm very you know, glad to be here and to be able to report positively. I understand the concerns about the risk register, and I do want to, you know, reassure the committee, not just that I'm happy to sort of talk to you about these points, but that we do have a good dialogue with Revenue Scotland, you know, on an ongoing basis about the progress, so that the implementation both this year of the two taxes and next year, obviously, the introduction of SRIT will be as smooth as possible for the taxpayers, because it's keeping the taxpayers happy, which actually makes sure that the tax keeps flowing, and we're very focused on that.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your evidence today. Thank you to colleagues for their questions. We agreed earlier on to take the next items in private. I therefore would like to close the public part of the meeting and just have a two-minute recess where we allow the official report on public and witnesses to leave. Thank you.